I'm using Python about 14 years, and in the last 4 years, I'm spending my time on the videos and Beast, which we will introduce soon. So everyone knows that Python thread sucks, right? Do you know why? Yes, right. So with the GIL, we can run only one Python code at a time. We can have only one thread running Python code. So basically, we are lost, right? But if we look inside the Python interpreter code, we can see that whenever Python calls blocking system calls or some other C code that does not need to access Python internals, we release the GIL. This is begin allow threads releases the GIL. And when the call returns, we take the GIL again. So actually, we can run while this thread is blocked. We can run Python code in another thread, or we can have a lot of threads waiting on blocking calls. So Python threads are actually useful. And we can do a lot of stuff concurrently, just not run Python code. When we're using thread, we can use really simple code. We don't need all the complexity of promises and callbacks and async await. We can just write simple code as if we are the only code running on this machine. Now the trouble starts when you have to access shared resources. Now VDSM is using a lot of threads. You cannot write VDSM in brainfuck because we don't have threads in brainfuck. So VDSM is a big Python application using really a lot of threads. We can have up to 150 threads depending on the configuration. And what is VDSM? VDSM is part of the OVIRT management system. On each hypervisor that OVIRT managed, VDSM is running and managing this hypervisor. And the purpose of VDSM and OVIRT is running VM. And VMs need storage. VM needs other stuff other than storage, but I'm working on storage, so we can ignore it. So what VDSM is doing is giving a virtual machine storage. And we typically use shared storage. When you separate your storage from a compute nodes, you can do interesting stuff like moving VM from one node to another node while the VM is running, because the VM is not tied to the host. Now, shared storage can be extremely fast. If you have expensive enterprise-grade storage with fast network, it's extremely fast. But it's also extremely slow if the storage is not responsive. For example, in this here, we have a DD program blocked on storage in this state. And this state means that this program cannot be killed, is blocked in the kernel. So VDSM is monitoring storage because with the information about storage health, OVIRT system can manage better virtual machines on the data and the hypervisors. And we separate storage to storage domains, which is a piece of storage that of some type. It can be an NFS mount or or a group of loons from a SCSI server. And we can have up to 50 storage domains on the host. And to monitor storage, we need to isolate the storage domains. So we have one thread per domain for monitoring the storage. Why do we need dedicated threads? Because if one storage gets low or maybe stuck, we don't want to affect other monitors. Now, VDSM is also using LVM. And when we use block storage like iSCSI or Fiber Channel, we create volumes using LVM. So VDSM is creating logical volumes for virtual machine disks or snapshots. And accessing LVM metadata can be slow. So VDSM caches the metadata. And when you cache stuff, life becomes tricky. you have to invalidate the cache. So the solution that was implemented in DSM is that the same monitor threads that monitoring storage also invalidate the cache. So every 5 minutes, monitor threads will wake up, invalidate the cache, and reload the cache from storage. So when you have 50 storage domains, and you want to invalidate the cache, and all of them are running together, you need to synchronize them in some way. So we have a special mutex for this. This is an example from the VDSM LVM cache code. We can see the code that invalidates the logical volume cache and the code that invalidates the reload the logical volume cache. And you can see that we take a lock before we invalidate or before we reload, we take a lock operation mutex, and we take the lock for invalidate operation here, and here we take the same lock for reload operation. It's similar to reader-writer locks, but here we have two operations. And when we invalidate, we just iterate over the dictionary, we keep the cache in the dictionary, and we change the entries. And when we reload, we have to go to storage, we have to run an NVM command, we have to parse it, and then update the cache. So this operation mutex cannot be standard lock because it will be too slow if every thread is taking, locking the cache and everything else stops when it has to update it. So we use a special lock that implements these rules. We can update the cache for invalid operation for multiple threads in the same time. And we can also have multiple threads reloading the cache at the same time. But we cannot do this in the same time, right? If the lock is locked for invalidate operation, you cannot reload stuff. And if your lock is locked for reload, you cannot invalidate. So how does it should work, such lock? Let's say we have one thread coming and acquiring the mutex for invalidate operation. Now, note that I'm using colors for the invalidate. Invalidate operation will be blue in this talk. Now the operation mutex is locked for invalidate. And now come another thread, and these threads want to reload the cache. Because the lock is locked, it has to wait. Now another thread that wants to invalidate can enter. This is the concurrency part of this lock, that we can have a lot of threads doing the same operation. When the first thread exits and the other thread exits, now the lock is empty, so we release the mutex. And now the thread that want to reload, that was waiting, can enter. And this is the code of the operation mutex. Basically, it's rather simple code. We are using a condition variable to synchronize. We keep the current operation and how many threads are inside. When we want to lock, we use the context manager. Not sure it's easy to see, but this is the context manager. So we acquire the mutex for some operation, we add to the caller so the caller can do the actual operation, and finally we release it. And this is the acquire method. This is the actual code from VDSM without the logs, because the logs make the code much harder to follow. But they are very important in runtime, as we will see later. And basically, we wait on the condition variable until the operation is either the requested operation or none, which means that the lock is empty and we are the first thread. And when we finish this loop, we set the operation if we are the first thread, and we increase the counter. Now, we need the counter to release the lock. Here we, when we release the lock, we decrease the counter. And if we are the last holder, we set operation to none, and we notify the other threads waiting on the condition variable. Now, this is a fragment from a VDSM log from a customer machine, simplified and removing a lot of stuff to make it fit in the slide. And we see here a lot of threads. Some of them want to invalidate, some of them want to reload. Again, I'm using the colors to make it clear. Now, what is the issue that we can see in this picture? What is wrong here? Well, it's wrong because all the threads are waiting. Invalidate threads are waiting, and reload threads are waiting. All the threads are waiting. And I've seen a lot of logs, and it turns out that usually we have one thread inside the mutex, and all the other threads are waiting. So basically, this mutex behaves like a regular lock with all this fancy code. And this can be really harmful because when we have a lot of domains and storage becomes slow and we are doing a lot of I/O, LVM commands become slow. So all the monitor threads are waiting one for each other, and then we get timeouts because we want to reload the cache, but we are waiting for 49 threads to do the same thing, and each thread takes maybe 10 seconds or 20 seconds, depending on the load. Just waiting for LVM command. And then we get monitor timeouts, and then Ovirt monitoring this host, think that this host cannot access some storage, and this hypervisor goes down. So this fancy lock becomes really harmful. So to understand how we can improve this situation, maybe we want to look at the tests, right? Because if you look at the tests of this code, maybe we can understand the issues. So what about the tests of the operation mutex? How they pass? Well, we found that we don't have any tests for this code. And we know that code without tests is broken. I probably did not invent it, but I couldn't find a better quote. So let's try to add tests to this code. Because if we can reproduce this issue in a test, it will be much easier to understand the issue and fix it. So the first test will be to do the same operation in the same time. This is a simple test using PyTest. You see that there is no boilerplate here. We create an operation mutex, and we have this worker function locking the mutex for some string, but the same string, and then sleeping 1 second. And we use a helper to run 50 threads in the same time and compute the time to run and complete this function. And we assert that we can do 50 concurrent sleeps in less than 2 seconds. Basically, this code should usually completes in 1 second and few milliseconds, but we are using more time, so this test will not become flaky because we need some time to start a thread and wait for them. So if you run this code, which basically is just running PyTest on the same directory, okay, before we run the thread, we need some code to run the threads, right? So I added this helper. It's not very interesting, but it's very useful to make the test fit in the presentation. So if you run this code, it passes. So this was easy. The code is not completely broken. Now let's try to add the second test. Now we want to simulate the refresh flow, which is much more complicated. And what do we do in the refresh flow? This is the actual code that VDSM runs when a monitor threads wake up. So first we invalidate the cache, and then we reload the cache. Go to storage, run an LVM command. We saw it before in the actual code. So these operations are not the same. Well, what is the difference between the operations? Well, invalidate is very fast. It just iterate over a dict and set some values. It takes microseconds. But reload means go to storage, run an LVM command, parse it, and update the dictionary. So it will take seconds or more. So this is a test implementing the same flow. We are using sleep again to simulate the actual LVM command, which is basically very similar. We run a command, we wait for the output, we read the output, and we wait for the command to finish. So most of the time you're sleeping. So we have here the same operation mutex, and we have something to simulate the cache, list of old values, and each worker will first lock the operation mutex for invalidate, and then we set the cache to invalid, which is very fast, basically what the actual code is doing. And then we lock the same mutex for reload operation, sleep a second, and update the cache to a new value. And again, we run 50 threads with this worker, and we assert that it will take less than 2 seconds because this part is really, really fast, so there's no reason why it should take more. And of course, we check that actual threads run, and we have new value in the cache. So this test fails, which is nice, but it's not consistent because sometimes it fails, sometimes it succeeds. It fails maybe 3 times when you run it 10 times. So it's not very useful because if you try to fix it, we never know if we run the test and it succeeded, we actually fix the problem, or maybe it's just luck. So how can you make it fail more consistently? And this is very easy with PyTest. We can use PyTest parameterize decorator. So now we are running this test 10 times without changing anything in the code. And this time, we can see that it still failed randomly, but our build fails always because we require that all the tests pass. So this is an easy way to overcome this issue. Now let's look at the test log. If you remember, we had logging code in the log that I removed, but in the actual code, we have logging, and it's very important to understand what happens here. And this is what we see, that the first worker took the mutex for invalidate operation, which is expected, but then it took the same mutex for reload operation, and all the other threads are waiting for invalidate operation. So we don't have any concurrency, because each time this happens, all the threads are waiting for the thread that got into the lock. So why does it fail? This is my theory. I didn't test it actually in the actual code running in the Python interpreter, but this is what happens here, I think. The first thread acquired the gil because only one thread is running. Then the same thread acquired the operation mutex for invalidate operation. Now all the other threads can get into this mutex, but they are not running. Only one thread is running. Now the first thread releases the operation mutex. So now any thread can get in, but this is the only thread running. And it did a very little amount of work. So Python has no reason to replace it with another thread. And now the same thread acquires the operation mutex because it is the only thread running this time, most of the time. And now it sleeps. So now it's even released the gil. So any threads can get into this operation mutex. But all the other threads want to do the invalid operation, but this thread is now locked for the reload operation. Now, how it should look if it worked? We expect that all the workers are enter the operation mutex for the first operation and finish, and then all the other workers, or actually the same workers, enter for the second operation and finish. And now we have concurrency. So, can you fix it? It looks like a hard problem. I mean, can we change the way Python schedules threads? Or maybe the kernel, right? It's not an easy way. So maybe we need to sleep here. So if we think about real world, maybe it can help. When you enter a building, then you open a door, you don't close it quickly. You hold the door and because you see another person coming, so you let the other person in, right? But threads are not polite. They don't know anything about other threads. And even if they knew it, they wouldn't be polite, right? So how can we make them polite? What can we do to make the thread polite? So when one thread enters the lock, it will let other thread enter the lock. So what we can do is take a little nap and wait a little, and then if other threads are around, they will get in. And this should be simple to implement. So I added this tiny slip here just before yielding, after we acquired the lock. So now if we have another thread around for the same operation, the other thread will get in. And this 10 milliseconds is not very important because the next operation is going to be reload, which takes maybe 10 seconds or 5 seconds. So nobody cares about these 10 milliseconds. But with the current code, we can have a wait of 50 times 20 seconds. So with this change, all the tests pass consistently. And let's look at the log now, the same log from the test. We see that all the invalid threads are entering, and when some of the early threads got out and try to reload, it will wait because the lock is full with invalidating threads. So this fix was tested and it actually worked in the real deployment. And this was shipped in over 3.6. So what are we done? We wrote one line of code, fixed the bug. Can we go home? Well, I don't think we are done yet. Why do we need the operation mutex? Is this the real problem in this code? Or we actually just fixed the symptom of the real problem? So we slept on it a little more. And we, in the next version, we came to the conclusion that we don't need operation mutex. We don't need to separate invalidate and reload operations. The fact that it was here in big fonts does not mean that it's actually needed. It's just that's the reason why inheritance is bad. You inherit bad code and it doesn't work. So, and actually, when we have multiple threads doing the same operation, accessing the cache, it's not thread safe because we iterate over the dictionary and change it. It's not thread safe when you do multiple operations on a dictionary from different threads. And the real problem is that monitor threads are not isolated anymore because they perform something that they should not do. The real problem is that monitor threads should not access LVM, which is a blocking operation. Monitor threads should only monitor. So in Overt 4.0, we redesigned the system, removed the operation mutex, actually replaced it with a simple mutex protecting only the dictionary. But this is a long topic. Maybe I'll talk about it in next year. Now, actually, removing code is the best thing we can do. I never fixed a bug in non-existing code. So now we are done. This talk is on GitHub. You can clone it and play with the tests and the code. And Overt is also on GitHub. It's an free software project. You're invited to join. And I want to thank Red Hat for paying me to write free software and for preparing this talk. So if you want a nice Red Hat, you're invited to check this URL. Thank you.